Stadium at the USTA's National Tennis Center in New York City, the men's championship, the finals, Edberg and Courier. I'm Pat Summerall with Tony Traber, and they are just about to get underway. And again, it shouldn't take too long for them to get loose. Temperature, as they said, was 87 degrees, but down on that court side and down on the court itself, it's much, much warmer than that.
That many really tough matches, so they should really be ready to go. It's a really a fine day to play tennis.
Well, neither player has much of an advantage as far as the rest element is concerned. Courier played the late match yesterday against Connors. Edberg played early against Yvonne Lindell, but neither match was very disappointment for Kansas City. We're live at the stadium here at the National Tennis Center in New York City for the men's final between Jim Courier and Stefan Edberg. As you might expect, the stadium is full. Courier will serve first.
Courier to serve.
And he's got a good one.
Quiet, please.
It's a deceptive type serve. He has a very quick motion.
Play.
And he will serve a few aces.
And he'll stay on that baseline most of the time. That kind of ground stroke was what sent Jimmy Connors back to California. Norm Crist, the chair umpire.
I have a feeling that right from the start of the match, Edberg won't be seeing a lot of really big serves because Courier wants to make sure he gets in a nice high percentage of first ones, knowing that Edberg's going to be looking to come in behind second serves.
I also think that Courier will serve a lot of second serves to the Edberg forehand and make him swing at it if he is going to come in. I was reflecting last night about the composure of Courier in his match with Jimmy Connors. The crowd was for Connors, very obviously, and he had a couple of questionable calls. He handled it all extremely well.
I didn't know you reflected, but that's good.
Here comes Courier, tries a drop volley, gets lucky when it ticks the top of the net because I think Edberg would have been there otherwise.
40-15.
Game Courier.
Courier holds and he leads. One game to love. The men's championship of the U.S. Open of 1991. Just beginning the men's championship. Stefan Edberg seated number two, Courier number four. They're in the finals. 15 love. Courier won the first game of the opening set.
30 love.
The surprising Phoenix Cardinals, 26-10 over the Eagles. They're 2-0. We have just begun here at the stadium of the USTA's National Tennis Center, the men's final, Edberg and Courier. Edberg at the top, Courier at the bottom of your picture.
40 love.
Courier won the first game.
But Courier can expect to see an awful lot of serves to his backhand or into his body. Edberg's favorite serve is going to swing to his backhand anyway, but against a two-hander, it's a good idea to jam him. I expect him to go there almost all the time.
Game
to 1-1. Two finalists. Edberg ranked number 2, Courier number 5. Stefan with 30 singles titles, 4 Grand Slam titles, $9.7 million in career earnings. Courier has a long way to go to match those statistics, but he is the French Open champion of 1991.
Courier's only 21, Edberg's right. 25, so he's been out there a little bit longer. Shouldn't miss that one.
Didn't really have to hit it that hard. That's the final score earlier. Rams upset the Giants. The Bears beat Tampa. Detroit, after that dismal showing last week against Washington, beat Green Bay. Atlanta's 0-2. New Orleans 2-0. Bill Belichick went from the Giants to the Browns, got his first victory.
Courier should have played it.
Yep, that's a bad mistake.
Well, that's something he didn't do yesterday.
Well, he didn't get the call he wanted. And this really was so close, he really should have played it. It even looks perhaps like it skidded off the line there.
I thought it did skid off the line, but when it's that close, you have to play it. Just for that reason, you may not get a call.
He did have a play on it.
Absolutely.
So he's had two real mental errors so far in this game. That's his coach, Jose Higueras, who's done such a great job with Jim Curry in the last year. Higueras is the one who helped Michael Chang win the French Open a couple of years ago, and now he's got his second French Open champion student.
Stefan Edberg's coach.
Silver Fox.
Yep.
He's got to like the way this game is going for Edberg. 3 break points right away. The Courier's maybe still just a little bit edgy being out there on the court.
Nervous is right.
dug himself out of a hole.
Yeah, that's a big moment for Courier. If he can save this game, he should really then settle in, and that'll be a big one for him. Because hey, man, I got out of a big problem there. You see, he's still breathing deeply, trying to relax himself.
Advantage Courier.
See the extreme grips. There's a very Western grip on the forehand of Courier. And when he goes the other side, see, he has to make a pretty good grip change. And that's where players try to rush him if they can, but it's not that easy. He's done this for a long time now, and he does it very well. You think that Courier is a little bit suspect to the low
advantage
ball because
Courier
of those extreme grips, don't you?
Yeah, I do. I that can be a real problem. And it's what Jimmy Connors tried to exploit yesterday in the semifinals, but Courier was just up to the task.
As a matter of fact, he hadn't lost a set in this event. And if he does win this in straight sets, he'll be the first one in the Open era to win here, first guy without losing a set. It'll be a terrific task.
That's out.
Deuce.
Those are the people who've done it without losing a set.
Kind of show-offy of you to do it twice, Tony.
Well, I didn't have much competition in those days, but Courier down here, you know, since open tennis in 68, when everybody was playing in the thing, pros and amateurs from that time on, that's a awfully good thing if he can do it.
This baseball fan
advantage
sure is being asked
Courier
to throw a lot of pitches in his so early on in this game.
That's one all first set,
but it's a game well worth fighting for.
That is a well-produced stroke, the Edberg backhand. This is just classic. Early preparation, just drives right through that ball, comes up the back of it just enough to create some topspin. Watch how quickly he sets up. Never looks rushed. That is fine backhand preparations. Follow through, just terrific.
Fourth deuce.
We're live for the men's finals at the USTA National Tennis Center in New York City. Edberg and Courier, one all in the first set. This is a tough game.
deuce.
One of the things that amazes me about this guy is we talked about how you change his grip. Go ahead, Tony. This is just the Edberg sneaks in and then goes in behind Courier. Smart play. You got a guy in a corner. He's got to get out of there to try to cover the big part of the court.
He runs so well with both hands on the racket while he's changing grips. Usually they say when you run as fast as you can, you got to pump those arms. He's
right.
Got both hands on the racket.
The fact is, if you do have awkward grips, you know, demanding grips, as Jim Courier does, as Monica Seles does, you've got to run fast because you've really got to get behind the ball. It's a difficult thing to prepare for. This man here can be stretched out of position and still get off a cleaner shot a lot easier. And he's finally got himself another break point. This is his fourth.
Since they've had open tennis here, the number one seed has only won seven times.
That goes back to 1968.
Right.
Yeah.
And the number four seed, which is Courier, only won twice in the open air. I was Nastasia and Vilas. And the two seed, which would be Edberg, has won seven times. I still think that's the side you have to try to penetrate on Edberg, the forehand. You know, he's worked his way back to number one in the world, so obviously it's not a weak shot, but it's weaker than the backhand side.
Look at Courier's shirt already. Games are one all, first set soaking wet. It's been a tough game here. Fan as well, Jack Nicholson. Thank you, Jack, for posing.
This is break point number five in this game for Edberg. Remember, he starts all start out at love 40.
Quiet, please. Thank you. First serve.
Hasn't been challenged much, has he?
Not really.
We always talk about Edberg serve, Becker, Sampras, people like that.
But Edberg finally breaks and leads 2-1.
Edberg leads. Any seat, please.
Well, we'll see how Courier responds now to that service break.
Quiet, please.
And also joining us today, our colleague, Andrea Joyce.
All right, Pat. You know, we told you yesterday how superstitious Jim Courier is. He, his parents were not in Paris when he won the French Open, so we asked them not to come here. So as it turns out, they're at home watching on television in Florida. And as it turns out, they can't even watch in the same room. Linda told me about an hour ago that she has to watch upstairs in the bedroom. And she just feels that Jim plays better when she's upstairs alone watching. So she obviously is not wild about missing all these Grand Slam events, plans to talk to Jim about it when he gets home. However, Pat, if it works again, she may not have anything to say about it. Back upstairs to you guys.
She may just stay upstairs.
Well, you know, as parents, they may be pulling for Curry to lose this one so they can come watch and play in some future ones and watch him win some.
Somehow, I don't think so. Well, Dade City, known for its production of citrus fruit, 6,500 people. Edberg's hometown, 22,000 plus. The stadium here seats 20,500. So we can build our own town here.
Falsterbo, Sweden is a very small town in southeast Sweden. His parents are there. They've come to Wimbledon a few times because he lives in London.
14.
But it's rare that they ever show up at these tournaments either, and he likes it that way. So do they. That's his first double fault. His father still works. Bengt is a policeman in Vostrovic. He said, he talks about the smallness of the town. He says, my father knows every crook there.
Up 3-1.
Long time girlfriend Annette Olsen. She used to date Mats Wielander when they were both in their teens, but she's been with Edberg a long time, and in fact they're now officially engaged. She too is Swedish, a model.
You know, talking about small towns, one of the players that won the men's double, John Fitzgerald, lives in a small town in Australia. We said, what's your phone number? He says, 2 dots and a dash. Now that's a small town.
15 love.
Neither one of these players comes from a real wealthy background. And I think that's part of the reason why they're both so good. They're both so hungry. Stefan Edberg's father, in fact, had to mortgage his house to pay for to pay for all the expenses he was incurring as a kid. But it all started to pay off pretty quickly.
That hunger is a great incentive.
Yeah, that'll do it.
Here's Currie in that last point. Watch him hustle forward. Won't take a very big swing at this one. And just whips over the top of a cross court. Edberg is trapped. Now he makes a low volley and it's defensive. See, he does a good job just to get it back. He's stuck now. He just hopes he doesn't get killed.
30-15.
Was wide.
Edberg tried to disguise that, it looked like. Tried to hold his shot as long as he could and just barely rolled it wide. You know, Murray, to pick up on your thought about rich kids from tennis and so forth, people think that tennis is a rich man's sport because it's been played at country clubs and things, but the players playing normally are not from wealthy families. Of course, it's different now. These guys are millionaires.
Edberg leads 3-2, first set.
Edberg to serve.
Oh! 15.
Edberg has been serving consistently harder at this tournament than he's been serving all year. And because of that, he's having a little bit of trouble at times getting as close to the net as he usually is for his first volley. We'll see if that hurts him when he goes for the big ones. That's just beautiful. And again, he's going to the Currie backhand. The Currie says he can handle that one. The two hands helps him handle the big Edberg kick.
Early preparation, a very short swing on that backhand. Watch this volley placed beautifully just inside the line. A Currie got the return down. He had Edberg stretched out, but the backhand volley of the number two seed is outstanding.
That's really going to be the measure of the match. Have a look at Mike Wallace there.
Most Grand Slam finals since 1985. Lindell leads with 13. Edberg is second, tied with Becker and Mats Wilander.
They'd rather talk about how many they've won, though. Edberg's won four. Or won the only Grand Slam final he got into. And that was the French earlier this year.
That was good news for Jim Currie, and that, as I was saying, that's the measure of the match, I think, right there. The return before, Currie had it up real high, and it was an easy volley for Edberg. But on this volley that Edberg had to make, you can see Currie was able to dip it down and make him hit it off his shoe tops. And that's going to be a very, very tough thing to do time and again today. So we'll be able to know who's winning the battle of serve and return just by seeing where that first volley is being played from. Oh! That one nice and low. Boy, that was a beauty.
And you see where Currie was. He was well inside the baseline. You can do this on a player's second serve. Watch where this lands. Pretty deep, not real deep. And there's Currie well inside the baseline, so he gets it earlier and higher. Gets over the top of it, gets it to turn down, and makes the guide volley up if he can even get his racket on it. Break point.
Oh.
Deuce.
When you're playing a good player and a good server, you do just all you can on the first serve, whatever you can do. But on the second serve, that's where you have to really try to do the damage. And there Edberg got the first serve in, so it paid off for him.
By continuing to go to the Courier backhand.
Advantage, Courier.
In general, that's a good play, but Courier's just sitting on this, waiting for it now. Again, he's got to mix it up, or he's got to, you can see, he's standing right in there, right on the baseline to pummel that away. I think he should go more into the Courier body and also surprise him by taking to the forehand as well.
See, Edberg's serve is a kick serve. He doesn't slice it very often.
He can flatten it, though.
Right at him too.
That's what he's got to do. He's got to jam, Courier.
There's not a tennis player that exists that likes this to happen, coming right at you, because it complicates your problem. You got to get your body out of the way before you can make a swing. Foot fault.
Beat Detroit. Toronto's lead increases over the Tigers to 5.5. Red Sox 17-6 over Seattle.
Up 15.
Wade Boggs kicked the field goal.
That Sparky Anderson do a great job year after year.
Amazing.
Nobody thought Detroit would do anything this year, and they've been in the hunt the whole time.
Courier serving a 2-4 in the first set of the men's final.
15-all.
Gets even at 15-all.
Stylistically, this match should be just like the one we saw in the women's final yesterday between the baseliner Monica Seles, Courier, and the serve and volleyer Martina Navratilova Edberg, but there's a big difference, and that's that Edberg is so much more solid off the ground. And Navratilova, I don't think, ever felt, as this man does, that she could stay out there with Selys and trade ground strokes. But Edberg's ground game has gotten so much more solid in recent years as we see him hoist this beautiful lob, untouchable, that he doesn't feel he's got a rush against Courier. If Courier comes in, Edberg can do the passing as well.
Thirty all.
Both encouraging numbers.
30-40.
Break point for Edberg. He'd love to get a second break in this first set.
Edberg leads 5-2 in the first set. The Fuji blimp soaring overhead, being piloted today by Captains John McGurk and Gary Fabian. It's like it just hangs up there, doesn't it? Hope they're not out of gas. Now they're both avid tennis fans. There is a key, points won on the first serve.
And he's not even serving at 40%.
Courier doesn't appear to have gotten anywhere close to as confident and loose as he was yesterday.
Well, you know, against Connors doesn't hurt you with a serve at all. Here's a guy that can really hurt you with a serve, and he also can stay with his Marisset off the ground. So it's a little different ball game. You look as good as your opponent lets you look. 3 set points now. Fully extended. Look at that placement right in the corner. You don't see Edberg go for many aces.
The first set of this men's final. 6-2, and we're live at the USTA National Tennis Center, the men's final of 1991, the Stadium Court. That is the first set that Courier has lost in this entire championship. And we're in the championship.
No, he'd only lost his serve, I think, 5 times. Coming into this match, he's lost it twice now, so now he's lost it 7 times.
Oh.
talked about the importance of Courier handling the Edberg serve. Edberg's only lost 5 points on his serve.
Wow.
So obviously he's serving well, backing it up well, and Courier does not have an answer at this stage.
Pretty close in terms of speed on first serves.
Courier especially gets in trouble when he misses that first serve. He's in the same mess that Ivan Lendl was in against Edberg yesterday, isn't he?
Yep.
Well, Courier says, you know, I used to just try to bang my way out of trouble. Now, he says, Jose Higueras has taught him that there can be a plan B, that you can rearrange a match if you try hard enough. Serving volley there, but the dip return was just too tough for him.
Three break points for Edberg, trying to jump out ahead in the second set.
Courier just said something to Higueras with his palms out.
Almost like, what can I do?
Yeah, desperation kind of emotion.
Yeah, it was like, do I have to hit a shot that good to stay in this match? He's still down two break points.
Right.
Says it was right there.
It's 116 miles an hour.
Here's another look, reverse angle.
That's pretty much where Edberg was pointing. Hard to know at that speed.
Isn't that the truth? Deuce.
Another one, 114.
That's his third.
There you see the difference in a guy like Edberg. He never complains or seldom complains. That we just walked away from. You know that was an ace, no question about it.
He makes things look so effortless. Even his complaints.
Anger's not one of his primary emotions.
Just like that, Game to Courier. We'll be back at the U.S. Open after this word from your local station. It's hot.
Again, we'll see Edberg come in behind Courier, forces him to hit that weak lob.
Whoa. Good shot. All you can do is watch one like that.
When you watch Edberg play as well as he's playing now, you wonder how he could go through 1991 just win three tournaments. He's not won a Grand Slam event this year.
His serve has been all over the place for a lot of 1991. His toss was moving around, and it really betrayed him in a lot of matches.
40-15.
Seems to have gotten his swing back, though.
It looks very smooth.
Yeah. And after losing 5 points in a row in that last game, having been up love 40, comes right back into Courier's face. And Jim has been struggling so much on serve. A lot of pressure.
Let's go down to Andrea Joyce.
All right, Pat, I'm with Jose Higueras, Jim Courier's coach. What does Jim need to do here in the second set differently?
Well, I think he needs to start serving a little better. He hasn't been getting too many free points out of his serve, and besides that, Stefan is playing really well, hasn't made hardly any errors. So hopefully he'll start having a little better, and Stefan, you know, start giving him a little advantage too.
What about Stefan's serve? Should Jim be doing something differently?
Well, Stefan is getting a high percentage of first serves, which, it keeps you guessing pretty much all the time. And he has a big kick to Jim's backhand, which bothers Jim a lot. Like I said, I think Stefan is playing really well. And, Jim has just got to keep hanging in there and hope, that the match level starts changing.
He fell behind early at the French Open. Can he turn it around here?
Well, I think he can. Obviously, the surface, I think, favors Stefan a little more. He's more a seven-volleyer, an attacking player. But I think Jim, if he plays well, I think he has a good chance.
Okay, let's go back upstairs. Thanks.
Courier serving 15 love.
Andrea asked a couple of good questions to Jose Higueras because at the French Open final, when Courier was losing to Agassi, there was a 20-minute rain delay, and in that time, Higueras was able to say to Agassi, look, you're not returning his serve too well. Step back about 10 feet and see if that helps. And, of course, it turned the whole Courier, and it turned the whole match around. Courier ended up beating Agassi.
Jose Higueras, of course, is one of Spain's great players, Davis Cup player for years.
The reason that I really don't think that would work against Stefan Edberg is if you step back 10 feet against his serve, you're so far away, and he's going to be coming up to net. I mean, Agassi wasn't coming up to net behind his serve, but Edberg would be. So I don't think that strategy would work.
Not on this surface.
Courier just served his second double fault, so it's 15-30.
He's pressing, really. He's pressing hard now. That was his third double fault. And again, not only is he feeling pressure off the Edberg serve, but even off the Edberg return. You can see he's down to about 40% now on second serves. He said at the beginning of the match he wanted to keep a high percentage of first serves in so he wouldn't have to go to the second ball against Edberg's return.
Edberg breaks.
He
leads 2-1.
A And now, this tournament summary, sponsored by AT&T, the right choice.
1991 U.S. Open facts, 14 days of play, 635 total matches have been played, 566 total players, and a new record attendance of 479,700. The National Tennis Center, and the final match of this championship of 1991, the men's championship. Stefan Edberg won the first set 6-2, leads 2-1, and will be serving in the second set. Best 3 of 5.
Missed it.
Love 15.
Kerr is not getting a very solid piece of the ball off the Edberg first serve. He's got to hope that Stefan misses some and see if he can handle the second serve better.
Right at him again.
Edberg's only lost 7 points on his own serve, so, boy, that's not only dominates on his serve, but it puts the added pressure on the courier serve, because he says, hey, if I'm broken, having no luck on the other guy's serve, I really got a problem. Aggressive play by Edberg. Good deep serve. Nice crisp volley. Watch him close in here. Of course, that was an easy one. Courier got the ball way higher than he wanted it and didn't get near the sideline.
Yes. First serve.
Look where he is, how he runs in after his shots. He could flatten out his serve and hit him even harder if he wanted to. But the fact is, because he kicks the serve in so beautifully, by the time he hits the first volley, that kick allows him to get closer to the net. So his first volley, he tends to be hanging right over it. Like that.
40,
even if he had to make a volley. See how close he was to it? I mean, that's it makes the first volley so much simpler for him. So even though there are guys with bigger serves like Ivan Lendl, Michael Stich, he's got his combination is more overwhelming point after point.
Quiet, please.
See, that last one of his was 99 miles an hour.
Edberg leads 3-1 in the second set. And Pat, the last word before kickoff. So far, Stefan Edberg has had the last word.
Yeah, that's an indication of how well he's playing. You don't see him try this shot very often. Heavy topspin. Look at how quickly it dips, the angle he gets on it. He'll brush up the back of the ball. Now, he makes that same kind of a stroke occasion when he goes over the top with the offensive lob, which he did earlier. So it disguises that shot and helps it.
Yesterday, after he beat Lendl, he said, I don't even have to think out there. It's all, the game is coming to him so easily. It must be nice. For tax reasons, he no longer lives in Sweden. He lives in London, though. He decided he wasn't one of those flashy Monte Carlo type guys. And for years, the London tabloids have been trying to dig up some good stories about Edberg. They finally came up with one last year. They found out he did his own laundry.
That's right. Well,
that's about the only dirt they could find on him was on his clothes.
Doesn't own a car. Oh! And he wants to be anonymous. Well, it's all working for Edberg.
15-30.
The power works. The touch works. Delicate touch there, the lob volley. Not a good shot by Courier, and that part was academic.
Not a good shot or not a good choice?
Well, end up not being a good shot. If he gets over his head, it's a good shot and a good choice. Normally from there, you throw up the high defensive lob and try to stay on the point. Edberg appears to have taken some of the stuffing out of Courier. He's not that bouncy, tenacious self that he usually is. That doesn't mean he's not trying or he's out of this match, but got him pretty well frustrated at the moment.
Boy, you're so right.
30, 40.
Tony Picard.
Again, a huge point for Edberg would give him two breaks in his second set.
Courier must be feeling at this point, that's pretty much what I've got to come up with. Very high-risk game.
Just about right.
That's the type of thing that Courier has to hope happens, that Edberg comes down a little bit, because he's been playing so well that there's just not much you can do, and he has to hope that Stefan resurfaces a little, lets him in.
Edberg's 3-2 in the second.
Quiet, please. Thank you.
Some ushers behind Courier had bothered him at the other end of the court. And now, once again, he's asking them to...
Usher a little
better.
You see this at tournaments all over the place, especially at the Australian Open. Painted faces of Edberg fans. I really think it started at the Australian because Edberg and Wielander dominated that event for a number of years.
15 love.
Edberg had three unforced errors in that last game, which was part of the reason that Courier was able to take it. And Courier's going to have to hope for more of the same, really. He's got to get a foothold into this match. And I do feel like one of the only ways he can do that is for Edberg's game to go away for a while.
Swedes in the U.S. Open Finals. Wielander twice. Borg never got it done.
On three different surfaces he tried, too. He couldn't do it on grass, clay, or hard.
I think that's really why he retired.
You think so?
Yeah, he'd win the French and Wimbledon, couldn't win here, so couldn't go on and try to win the Grand Slam.
Now, of course, the Australian Open kicks off the Grand Slam, but it used to be at the end of the year. Tony, I remember how much the Australian press used to root for Borg here. They wanted to see him win it.
Sure.
So that they'd come on down. Just never happened.
I think Courier has to be very disappointed in his inability to penetrate the Edberg second serve. You understand when Edberg gets his first serve, and it's going to be tough to handle. But the second one, as good as it might be, Schultz would be handled better.
Like that. That'll do it.
Courier's almost got to step up to the baseline, as he did here. Take that ball sweet and low, nice and early.
He just been had to get a good piece of it. He's been sort of hitting it off center.
That one too. He stepped up a little tighter. I think that's got to be the play, really.
It's what it looks like if you're court level.
Very compact swing you've got to take.
Yeah, 100 miles an hour. It gets on you pretty quickly.
Edberg leads 4-2.
Edberg leads 4-2. Then Courier's in trouble. No emotion.
Courier has a sister, Audra, and a brother, Chris, who you know are pulling like crazy for him.
Say no emotion, Pat. Jonas Svensson, a good friend of Stefan Edberg's, a fellow Swedish player, a good one, in fact, says of Edberg that there's a Swedish word that describes him. Swedish.
No emotion. The men's final to USTA's National Tennis Center in New York City. Stadium packed. And that's the situation. Edberg won the first set 6-2, leads 4-2 in the second. Courier serving 15-all. One of the few times that this offensive lob has worked today for Courier. Edberg was closing. That one landed just inside the baseline.
Got a real problem against Edberg. He talks about how much more patient he's gotten on the court, that he waits for his shots. But against a guy like Stefan Edberg, I mean, patience is not a virtue, because he's going to rob you of time, of preparation, of shot selection.
So very graceful.
Was one of the better tosses for Courier. That one was up and into the court. He's been tossing that ball almost straight up overhead, and when you advance the weight forward, you get ahead of the ball and you don't serve it as accurately. It's more of a pulling motion than a hitting.
Game to Courier.
Edberg leads
4-3 in the second. Not to worry, the U.S. Open's in good hands.
Best seat in the house.
Emily Dickinson said, "Hope is that thing with feathers."
Behind the court, please.
Jim Courier could use a couple of seagulls at this point.
Well, to show you the effectiveness of the Edberg serve, he's winning 77% on his first serve and 76% on his second serve. That's awfully strong.
Courier guessed right. Couldn't do anything with it.
This is where he makes a mistake. He's in a position to drive that ball.
Yeah, but I think he's decided he's going to try to take Edberg off the net. Maybe he thinks if he can lob effectively enough. We saw him with a beauty just a little while ago. That Edberg won't keep closing like this.
13, lob.
Scary.
Game, Edberg. Edberg leads.
Strong game by Edberg. In the past, look at some of the trouble that Edberg has had here at the U.S. Open.
Especially last year in 1990 when he lost in the first round. He was coming up a 21-match win streak. He was the number one player in the world, and he lost to Alexander Volkov.
Quiet, please.
That was a real big shock. But he said he had so much tennis in him by the end of, you know, by the time the Open started. He and Boris Becker have been ping-ponging the number one position back and forth all year. For the third time now, Edberg has regained it now that Becker lost here in the third round.
Who is it? Here's another look and see that the long run by Courier, well behind the baseline, just barely got his racket on before it bounced twice. See where he has to come from. When you're in that kind of a situation, like he tried to make a sharp angle, knowing that the point's over, he doesn't make something a winner outright.
That's good.
Oh!
40-30. Four in the second. Back at the U.S. Open of 1991, you're looking at the stadium. Pat Summerall with Tony Travert and Mary Carrillo, along with our colleagues Andrea Joyce and Tim Ryan. Edberg serving for the second set. He won the first.
15-love.
This whole second set, he's only lost 4 points on serve.
Now by Courier, the return was low. He had time to set up on this one and just really overpowered Edberg with that back two-hander.
He almost takes no backswing with that two-hander.
If Courier can break here, the crowd will get more involved. Uh-huh. That can give him a lift and get him really fired up and into this match a little bit. To this point, Stefan Edberg has pretty much been dominating.
Sir, find a seat at the end of the court. Any seat.
It doesn't bother Stefan much because he knows he's going to get some of those called on him, and he just goes back about his business. What a great volley that was.
Courier just shook his head.
He's saying, man, I can't hit it harder than that.
Can't get it lower.
No, I got it nice and low. Here's what Edberg was up against. See, he just got to the service line. And that ball hit right inside of the sideline.
Another football called. As you say, Tony, it's common with the Edberg match because he wants so badly to get into the net.
I didn't see any signal. Courier called it out.
Well, our Edberg. Edberg doesn't like the call. Edberg cuts off this little next volley here. He goes to the angle.
Quiet, please.
He thinks he's made it. See, he clenches his fist. Then he gets the out call. Break point. Very good offensive lob and a great effort by Edberg.
Deuce.
Twice now Courier has played terrific ad court points, and twice Edberg has come up with something even better.
I don't think Edberg was trying to hit that overhead there. He was just glad to get his racket on it. It happened to go there. These fully stretched, leaning backwards, right, pop the wrist early to get that racket head to come back down, bring that ball down the court. Courier saying, good gosh, what do I have to do?
I think that's what he said.
That was called good.
Advantage Edberg.
Yes, it was.
I couldn't see. It looked like it was awfully close.
I can't believe the clutch volleys he's come up with in this game. And Couriers couldn't be doing much more.
That was
to try
brilliant.
To get it by Edberg. He's right. Tried to hit through him. He's tried to hit over him.
Quiet, please.
Yeah, there is no question that overhead was good.
Well inside.
And now it is a set point for Edberg.
Set,
to polish it off. Second
6-4.
Set to Edberg. 6-4. He won the first set 6-2.
Here is a nice way to finish off the set. Right smack on the line.
Courier thought it was wide. He's still complaining about it.
Umpire Norm Crist, here's another look. Looked like it hit half the line to me.
Yeah.
And it's certainly too close for an overrule. There has to be a clear mistake for the umpire to overrule. So here we go, set number three. Edberg has two in his pocket.
He just continues at that relentless pace.
But Courier started getting piece of the ball there. Annette Olson, Edberg's fiance. Courier started to get into that match just a little bit more there, started to return a little better, make some better passing shots.
It took a brilliant game for Edberg to secure that second set.
Love, 30.
From above. Stadium Court, the USTA's National Tennis Center. Men's finals. Stefan Edberg, Jim Courier. Love 30. First game, third set.
Oh.
this is real trouble because, as often happens sometimes, in the span of about 10 minutes, you finish off the last game of one set and then you break right away at the start of another one, and in those 10 minutes you can lose a whole match.
Of course, Edberg wants to give Currie the feeling he's going to dominate and continue to dominate, not let him in it at all.
Edberg breaks. He wins the first game of the third set. As the sun sets over the skyline of Manhattan, that's the situation in the U.S. Open of 1991. Stefan Edberg, 6-2 in the first, 6-4 in the second. He's up. Break and serving. Had one love in the third.
And Edberg's only lost 12 points in 9 service games. So that's how well he's dominated on his serve.
Currie, even in that last game, and I'm not, he's pitching a shutout. More moving around the court. That's what Currie says he wanted to change this year. He's worked hard not to be so predictable, just a banger. He lost a match to Andres Gomez last summer, and Gomez had said after the match to the press that Currie just, you know, you knew just what he could do, and he had a limited game, and that really stung Currie. He's tried to change that around. Gomez also very kindly said to Currie, look, you win points, you know, you don't have to win every single point. Your opponent will lose some too, and it all. Boy, that looked out.
I think he agrees with you. Not him. I think that's a bit of sarcasm. Well, it looks pretty good.
It was awfully close if it wasn't good.
Do go quickly when he serves.
You got a little stat here, Patrick, that
right.
When Edberg's average time in his service game is 3 minutes and 20 seconds, Currie 5 minutes and 10 seconds. So he's obviously struggling harder to hold serve. He's been broken 4 times. Currie has not been able to break Edberg yet.
Top Grand Slam records in 1991. Currie has the lead at 20-2. Edberg is 20-3. Becker's 20-3.
If Currie
18-3, excuse me.
I was going to say, Pat, if Currie were to win this, having already won the French, I'd be hard pressed not to think that maybe he was the number one player in the world this year, winning the French and the U.S. Open. But Edberg is number one. And if he wins this, I think I just have to give him the nod. Wimbledon, of course, was won by Michael Stich. Boris Becker won the Australian Open.
Again, some distraction bothered Currie. Oh! the only place I can think of where you get applauded for sitting down if you're in the back row.
That's right.
See, this is Currier's problem at this point. He's got to go for more and more gambles. He's like a blackjack player. He's got rotten cards, and he starts doubling up on his bets.
Well, he's not getting any first serves in, so he's that's one of his weapons is gone.
Quiet, please.
And then the constant pressure from Edberg sort of dispirited at the moment. Oh!
Your more avid tennis fans, Wilt Chamberlain.
How'd you like to be serving from that vantage point, huh?
He didn't forget to grow, did he? Boy, he's big.
And what a nice guy. He's out on all the courts watching juniors. He's watching women's singles. Yeah, he just loves it all.
A friend of mine once asked him how his overhead was. He said, "Don't know. Nobody ever lobs me."
Live at the USTA's National Tennis Center in New York City, the men's final, and that's the situation. It's been all Edberg. He's up 2-love in the third set. This is the championship.
And he's got a break point here.
Beautiful day in New York. I don't think either one of them are thinking about that at the moment. He's up 3-love in the third, and we'll be back at the U.S. Open after this word from your local station. U.S. Open at the USTA's National Tennis Center, the men's final in the stadium.
Ball.
Stefan Edberg has been in charge. Obviously, Courier thought it was playable. Norm Crist in the chair. Said this before, let's go up to Andrea Joyce.
That's right, Pat. We're up in the nosebleed seats, and we have run into a couple of rabid Stefan Edberg fans. What would inspire you to do this, to paint this flag on your face? He's such a quiet guy. It doesn't seem like he would inspire that kind of behavior.
No, but when we're here, is get the finals. We do anything to get to see him.
You're on vacation here.
Yes, we are only on vacation, but when we're here, is get the finals. We do anything to see him.
So you saw the Statue of Liberty. Is this the highlight?
Yeah.
This is the highlight.
This is the highlight.
All right, Pat, if you thought all Swedes were quiet, I invite you to come up here and spend a couple of minutes up here with us. Back to you guys.
Well, looks like it's going to be a long vacation. Love 30. Edberg serving. Maples and Donald Trump enjoy, I think.
Thirty all.
The Edberg serve has just been so dominant that Courier hadn't been able to do enough on the returns. You got to give Stefan Edberg all that credit. He's serving so well and backing it up.
He's just moving so, I mean, it's
really
such liquid grace. It seems sometimes as though he's just hovering right over the court.
Especially
when you compare him with Courier. He's so much more, this guy dances, as everyone says, and Courier much more a ground hugger. I mean, you could see all the effort involved in his, in the way he plays. See all the sweat from the practice courts and all the grit.
Game to Edberg.
Edberg leads 4-1.
From the Fuji blimp above, great aerial shots of the Flushing Meadows, the stadium, the surrounding area, all coming from the Fuji blimp. On a wonderful day for almost everybody.
Quiet, please.
This is Donna Mills, another avid tennis fan.
Talk about his movement, Edberg's movement, when tennis was still an exhibition sport at the Olympics in 88. Edberg played it, well, for the first time, I should say, 84, when both he and Steffi Graf won it. And he said he'd love to go and watch the track stars compete, because he said if he had a choice, if he weren't a tennis player, he'd like to be a sprinter.
Certainly moves well.
Yeah.
Friend of yours, Tone?
Yeah, great Pancho Segura, the gray-haired gentleman there from Ecuador. One of the most popular players to ever play. And Jack Kramer said that his two-handed forehand was the greatest single shot ever produced in tennis.
Mm. Pretty fine tribute. 15-all.
The last time I saw Edberg play this well, it was probably 2 years ago when he won Wimbledon. But this is on a hard court against a pretty tough hard courter.
Look where Edberg was. Watch how close he gets this for this final volley. Good penetrating approach and keeps moving forward right up near the net. That's really beautifully done.
I mean, he's won 4 Grand Slam titles, Edberg, but they've all been on grass. 2 at the Australian when it was still at on grass, and 2 at Wimbledon. This is going to be a breakthrough for him, just as it was for Boris Becker when he won this title.
30-all.
30-all.
Becker wanted to prove that he wasn't just a grass court player. And I think Stefan Edberg is very much proving the same thing today. Forehand of his didn't miss by much.
No, it didn't.
Heaven knows, and these fans know, Courier needs this game.
Well, they want to see more tennis too.
Oh.
four doubles false. And it's deuce.
A fan just reminded him of the Kriegstein match, trying to get him to make a comeback as Connors did last Monday.
Trying to put the finishing touches on and rushing a little bit.
He won the first set 6-2, the second 6-4. Up 4-love in the third.
If he can get this, we only have three breaks, we lead in 5-love. And he's only lost 14 points on his serve, so. You know how badly Currier needs this.
Third set. U.S. Open White Championship of 1991, the men's final, and Stefan Edberg very, very much in command. Be something that gets this guy excited. I mean, mud wrestling or something.
Edward says, I think ordinary people are much more happy than the jet set and celebrity people. He says, my parents, whom I respect as my greatest friends, taught me early that happiness is often a modest thing. It's got nothing to do with money or fame. He lives that way. He doesn't want anyone to try to change him.
The match is 2 hours old now. Hedberg won the first two sets and leads this one 5-love in serving. Seems to always be where he's supposed to be.
He does. He's just got such great instincts, especially up at the net. But again, this is how he was beating Lendl yesterday. Very little. There are no moments that have to pass between his muscles and his brain. The synapses are firing so simply.
He doesn't take any more steps than anybody else. He just gets there quicker. Match point.
Quiet, please.
Well, forget the mud wrestling. U.S. Open title excites him.
That's pure joy from Edberg. I've never seen him really quite that emotional. That's lovely to see. And why shouldn't he be feeling this way? He only lost 15 points on serve. He was brilliant from every part of the court. And again, he did it on a surface where he's never won a title this big before.
Here's the way it looked, match point.
Pretty.
Right now, let's go down to Tim Ryan.
All right, thank you, Pat. There's a close-up look at the best player in the game today. He is ranked number one by virtue of advancing to the semifinal and the loss by Boris Becker early in the tournament. And he is... For nearly 2 weeks, New York belonged to Jimmy Connors. But tonight, it belongs to Stefan Edberg, the 25-year-old Swede who has won his first U.S. Open championship. And here is match point. Edberg taking a net ball, and with that classic backhand volley down the line for victory, and finally a show of emotion our commentators were hoping to see. And for the presentation, let's go to Tony Trabert on the stadium court.
All right, Tim, ladies and gentlemen, how about a great hand for two wonderful champions? It is now my pleasure to introduce Mr. Bill Bruce, who is the Vice President and General Manager of the Infinity Division, and Bill to present a check to our runner-up, Jim Courier.
Thank you, Tony. Jim, you had a great 2 weeks. We thank you for some exciting tennis, and maybe to make you feel a little better, a runner-up check on behalf of Infinity Luxury Automobiles for $200,000.
Jim, congratulations on a wonderful tournament. I know you're a little disappointed today, but you ran into a guy that just played way too well, right? Served too well?
Well, I can't really say that I played too badly today. It's just that he was all over me from the beginning, and I'd like to congratulate Stefan because I've never seen him play that well before, and he's a great champion.
All right, Jimmy, thank you very much. And now, Bill, you have a check for our winner, Mr. Stefan Edberg.
I sure do, Tony. A true champion, played very well, and I'm proud to present you again on behalf of Infinity Luxury Automobiles a little bigger check. In fact, it's $400,000. Congratulations.
Stefan, congratulations. Two Australian titles, two Wimbledon titles. We know you wanted this badly. Have you ever played better than you played today?
No, I think, honestly, this is probably the best match I've ever played, and I didn't think I could play as well.
You were knocked out in the first round last year. You come back to win it. That's got to be an awfully good feeling for you.
Yeah, I think it's great what happened last year. I was very disappointed losing first round. So, you know, I gave it all I had this year, and I had a very lucky year, so I'm starting to like New York too.
All right, Stefan. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce Mr. Robert Cookson, who is the president of the United States Tennis Association and the chairman of the U.S. Open, to present the championship trophy.
Thank you, Tony, very much. on behalf of the United States Tennis Association and its 435,000 members, I'd like to present this trophy to the 1991 men's singles champion, Stefan Edberg. Right.
The 1991 U.S. Open men's champion, Stefan Edberg.